Yeah, it's working.
Excellent.
Awesome. Finally. So I'll start presenting. So, can you hear something?
It's going to be very big today.
So, yeah. Test.
Right now it was switched off the YouTube, the ray tracing has connection.
Okay, so.
It's telling that it's working.
Okay, cool. So, yeah, and here I am. So, the title is called Gory Tale, from a game jam game to a published title here at APT Game Generator. So, who is this dude standing in front of you? So, my name is Ģirts Ķesteris. I'm Latvian, from Latvia, and I'm actually born in Valka, so I'm almost an Estonian. I am also a game developer wannabe, the more you know. So, so around 2007 I stumbled across a game called Mountain Blade. It was fun, I got super addicted to it. But one of the things I started doing, I started sort of modifying it. For example, I wanted some pink horses or red horses or orcs in women's clothes, something like that. I wanted to create my own mod at Mountain Blade. I started doing some Python scripting. And I failed at it. Then I just dropped it. And later on, I tried to develop my game from scratch in Java. Who creates a game in Java? And I failed at that too. Except, like, I guess my Minecraft was made in Java. So, yeah, who makes a game in Java? So then around 2010, I started messing with a small game engine called Unity, and then this is my first game. I mean, yeah, it was just a scene. These were my first 3D models. I mean, that's supposed to be a lantern there, and it's a weird floor, and actually, in the middle there was a boss, and basically it was a cube with my friend's texture applied to it, and it was always looking at me and doing some stupid stuff. So, and it even had credits. So yeah. So, why am I telling this? I'm gonna tell. Actually, this between that. And now there's a lot of stuff, so I'm gonna skip forward to nowadays. So who am I now? So I'm a senior Unity developer at Orange LV. There's the old and the new logo. The new is not yet official, that official yet. So I'm AR and VR developer there. I'm doing a bunch of AR and VR stuff there for 3 years, almost 3 years now. So I'm also a member of Latvian Game Developers Association, as you can see maybe here. I'm lecturing 3D development, actually it's just Unity. I mean, coding mostly, and how 3D math works, and how you create something from 3D models, and how it works. So it's in Vidzeme University of Applied Sciences, which is located at Valmiera. So, yeah. So, another thing I'm doing, I'm currently, I am a master's student, finally, in VR and smart technologies. So, I'm about to finish in this January. I'm gonna finish my master's thesis. So, but why am I here? Now the slides change from white background to black background. Because so it would be harder for you to read. So I'm main guy at NJARG. So I'm gonna pronounce it a bit better next time. So yeah, it would be great if I get to the point. Why am I telling all this? So I am here because of a game called Gory Tale. Yeah, this is a poster. This is a poster for the game called Gory Tale, and it's intentional to have similarities to do, except maybe you can see what's the difference here. Basically, you have to shoot cute stuff and kill it, and you know, pink candy line sort of. Yes, it looks something like this. You basically take a saw and saw those little happy things. Imagine happy three friends, except you are the one who's the murderer. Yeah, and like you can do also stupid things like this. It's this weapon is called, it's a trumpet, but it's called Doot. It's a stupid reference to Doom. So yeah. Also, you can hit them with a fish. One of our team members' nickname was Fish, in Latvian Zivs, so that's reference to him. So how it all started? That's one of the things. Why am I here, and why I am speaking here? How it all started? Actually, where it all started? It's here in this very room. I think I could say that it started here. So it was Ludum Dare 40. We were a delegation of Latvian game developers coming here, and yeah, we didn't know that what we were gonna create. I had an idea. Not really. I had an idea that I could make a game about Arnold. So it's not a tumor. So you know why, probably. So. And the game was called Get to the Chapel. Yeah, so it was all about Arnold Schwarzenegger. So yeah. So it all started here. And what was the main thing about that game? It was the audio and the. Okay, of course, the main menu was awesome. If you would move the cursor around, the eyes would follow. It was pretty nice. So the most funny thing about this project, it was how we recorded the audio. It was all about the Arnold voice lines, and about, for example, a chopper sounds like chop 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 chop, or pew 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 pew, and that kind of basically voice sounds. That was my first time where I let's go with it. Let's try. Audio focused game, because I haven't done that, didn't do that prior to this game, so it was fun, and we created something really terrible. Yeah, this is how it looked in the game. It was pretty terrible. I mean, but yeah, you're Arnold. You need to save Nicolas's cages from predators. And get to them to the chopper, which at the end explodes. So there was no point of it. So you could technically shoot all Nicolas's cages, yes, something like that. So because if you would ask them to follow you, they would follow you for 5 seconds maybe, and they would then just wander off. So it was really annoying. So, and it turns out we got the first place. So this is where stuff sort of started. So we qualified for game camps with this game, but then we thought, do we want to finish this game? I don't think there will be a lot of gameplay for it. Maybe not. So we tried a different terrible game. So it was a stealth game set in farmland where you had to save farm animals from evil farmer, because you know, animals are suffering there. So you are the one who will save them. And it wasn't that good. And what happened next? We went to Ludumdare 41, again in Tartu. Why? I don't really know. It just happened that we just gathered the car, just a car full of people, and just went to Ludumdare. And I had just watched one of SpongeBob SquarePants episodes where Plankton was inside SpongeBob's head, and it was this terrible pinkish world. Like, geez, it was so happy and terrible, and yeah, I said, oh yeah, I definitely need to do something about it, something similar like that. So So we tried to do that in Ludumdare 41, and it worked, and Gory Tale was born. It looked like this. Yeah, pinkish. Except there were like marshmallows, watermelons, and slurpees. And voice acting by me, that I did terribly, and voice actor by the other Ģirts, called Zivs or Fish, who did the small creatures. Oh no! And that kind of. I want to be your friend! That kind of voices. He did that, those. So, we won. And that was a different thing. So, we won with this game. And we qualified for game camps again. It was like, twice now. So, yeah, that was something. So, this was the moment where NERG was born. But we had a different name back then, but we used this Njarg a lot because Arnold voice and whatnot. So we switched the name. So what happened later on, we decided that we want to merge the Get to the Chopper team. We had this one game with the team, with Gory Tale team, and we were 5 people already. Yay. And let's finish Gory Tale. And it turned out to be a Latvian and Estonian studio, except one guy who's a surgeon who's Turkish, but I would call he's Estonian now. So, the plan. Yeah, I really look like a guy with a plan back then. At least what I think now, when I look back to the guy. That happened in April 2018. I looked at the guy, and he looks to me, myself, then like a Joker. Do I look like a guy with a plan? So, but we sort of had some sort of plan. So, must have a cheesy story. That was the first thing. Yeah, because, yeah, no multiplayer. Why no multiplayer? Because one of my team members were about multiplayer. He was like, oh yeah, multiplayer, and I had several games projects that were multiplayer games, and I didn't want to mess with those for some time. So I wanted to have a simple project to finish fast, and there need to be three bosses and three scenarios with it. First one, overgrown marshmallow. Why not? Because, you know, it will be just copy paste, scale it up, add some different mechanics, and you have a boss. Wow, nice. Candy Mountain. Yeah, I like Charlie the Unicorn. And unicorn, of course. Charlie the Unicorn. For some reason, I wanted a unicorn. Cool bosses. And then launch it on Steam. Simple plan, right? Let's see how it turned out. We're back to the poster. Gory Tale. So in the game, it looks something like that. So you can flip them off. Those jumping marshmallows. Yeah. Not just that. So I'm gonna talk about development process. That was definitely fun. Yeah, I would say something like that, where shit hit the fan. So one of our milestones were like, there were game camps events, so we were pretty sort of preparing for them. Well, they're the easiest milestones where I could specify my processes in parts. So one first thing. Oh, we have this prototype. We have this game made in Game Jam. Do we want to? How do we move on? First, we created game design document, some tasks, social profiles a bit later, and other stuff like Discord channel and, you know, starting like GitHub repository. It was there already. Basically started some organizational stuff so we can organize our work, because we are not in the same room and we are all working remotely. What happened, I went full control freak. Like, I was the owner of the project. I created all the tasks, I created the Git report bots. I just wanted to make processes more optimized, so.
Oh,
yeah, cool.
Just listening and writing an act
Okay, cool. I'm gonna continue.
Yes, please.
So where was I? So it was the game jam was in April. So during May, we had to prepare to game camp Skotka event happening in Finland. So we had to switch from game jam mess project to a working prototype. The gameplay was there, but we had to transfer to a working prototype that's a stable version, sort of, where I added like stuff like fixed main menu, gameplay, switched the whole, it didn't look like I switched the gameplay mechanics that much, but the whole backend was changed. 90% of the core was changed in, at least code was changed. So the project has a bit more stable backbone. So then we went to Game Camp Skotka event June 2018. And after that, we participated in several AGDA, that's like Latin Game Developers Association stands, and there we collected valuable feedback about our game. It's a fast-paced shooter game where it's pretty important that you just jump it in there and enjoy it. So when people were telling what they feel, what they think about the game, that's one thing. But the second thing, the most valuable thing, is I could see how they play the game, and that was one of the they don't understand how hitting works or shotgun works. They're doing this thing. I should balance the shotgun a bit and change it here and there. So after it started to look like this, it didn't really look that much different, but it had like new weapons like saw and rifle, and it was a bit more. Oh yeah, and we had something else, little marshmallow. We had it there. So it was our first boss, and this game, just from this point on, it was all about juvenile jokes. So we even had t-shirts at the event. Yeah, cool. So here's the full team of five of us, of initial team, and we did great. Then I would say there's development process number two. Second part is, that was July to October, and around July the enthusiasm decreased. In the projects, there's this first wave of enthusiasm, like everybody wants to participate. They want to do stuff, and then suddenly the slope goes down, like spiraling back down, and this is the point where projects die. And we didn't, because I'm a stubborn donkey. That's one of the reasons, maybe, I don't know. Somebody needs to keep the project alive. Somebody needs to communicate. Somebody needs to still check how is it going and that kind of stuff. So at this point, we created the first scenario prototype. This was the first scenario, first story. Scenario one, where you can just, you had a cinematic tutorial and gameplay from level one to little marshmallow boss. This one. I have lots of flipping off images because it's a streamer, influencer attraction. So, and we even created a Steam page. It was listed there, and it was a pretty good. We created it around like in early October or late September. I can't really remember, but it was a good tactic so we could get some wish lists before the release. And if I would do that again, I would create it in May or June when we decided that we want to do this project. So we went to Game Camp Swisby event, which happened in Gotland, Sweden. Then the project was, I would say, it had identity crisis. And then we started looking for a publisher. So it was the point where I was, oh geez, what am I doing with this project? How this second scenario will look like? Is it really that well? How the third one is, and this is the point where our marketing guy left the team because of personal problems. So this is one of the reasons what sparked identity crisis and especially the looking for a publisher phase. So this was the story first level. It looked pretty okay, pretty nice. So at the Visby event, we saw a thing, a toaster, when we were eating morning breakfast. And yes, we made a toaster in the game. It was an exploding toaster. Why not just add some additional layer of silliness? Currently, I would say the weapon what's in the Steam, it's a bit OP, I would say, but its aim mechanics is not that great, so it kind of balances it. So then what happened? I spoke to several publishers. I'm going to note some of them. One was Raw Fury, and one was Devolver Digital. Raw Fury were considering us for some time and then dropped us. Devolver, oh yeah, cool. Yeah, cool project. No. And Armor Games, I didn't the talks stuck, I would say. So, and then there was development process part three, November to March, and switched development. I fully switched development to Mac somewhere in the middle of this process. Why am I telling this? Why it's relevant? Because prior to it, I was developing on a Windows-based system. Why I switched to Mac? Because it was getting closer and closer to the release, and I had to ensure that the game performs well on the Mac systems, especially the one I had is pretty crappy one. We had a stand on Game On. It was pretty awesome. I wasn't expecting the event to be that great. It was great. So I met some of the cool people of game industry, cool people. For example, Rami Ismail and Arnold Nessis. And this was a phase where me and alone, but mostly two members actively were working on the game. So technically our team was not five, but six people at that stage, but only one or two members were actively working. So it was me and somebody else. So, but then scenario two and scenario three was created. It took too long because I had to be part of it. I took full control over our marketing because we didn't have like a marketing person, and I didn't want to get additional guy. So we already have like a bunch of people in credits. So yeah.
Question from the stream.
Yeah.
What specialities team members have?
So I'm gonna go to that a bit later. after development process, I'm gonna tell. I'll have all the people who participated. I'm gonna tell who did that, did what. So, okay. Then I'm gonna answer this question.
Okay. Cool.
So, and then I went to GDC. That was early March. Sadly, we didn't get the all team. Like, at least I wanted to have a second one who would be the second from my team to go to GDC, because it's always nice that you have a second member who can fill when for example if you're going to some conference event and the guy can be on the stand and vice versa. So this was our game on event and our game on stand. I don't know. We were with the game. We were in many stands, and guess why our game stood out from the rest? Pink tone, right? It's like Tiny Build has this orange tone. They like excel. Like they look. They're the first thing you see from the crowd. It wasn't really intentional. It just about the game. The pink tone. So this is how the scenario 2 looks like. Yeah, it was Candyland. Why it's blue? I don't know. Just happened. I didn't change it that much. I liked how it looked, and that stuck. It had bananas, donuts. The donuts were the most fun AI enemy that I made. It took me 1.5 weeks to do that, but it was worth it. So it's just not, I had to optimize it a lot because there are like many of them on the map at the same time. Second boss, Candy Mountain. This was pretty hard boss. Technically, it's not that hard to code it, but the problem was user experience. It took me a while until I got it sort of right. I think this one is the weakest of all bosses, but it's a boss, all right, and it's fun. Yeah, she's my wife.
Okay.
My dear wife, Evita.
Okay, thank you.
So, yeah, back to the thing in the background. You can see some weird green fumes coming out, or it's one of the enemies that's causing it. So I would say in each scenario we had like three basic enemies. Two were melee, one was ranged, and one was special. In this one it was a cheese guy running around and farting, and you just don't get into those fumes. Avoid them. And also one of the best things is that these cheese people created smoke cover for these. This guy is called Chili. He just runs towards you and explodes from lava. Yeah, it's like in Serious Sam there were these headless bombermen. So this was referenced to Serious Sam. So the story was pretty close to Serious Sam, and the gameplay was and the feeling a bit more like Serious Sam. The main guy was like an ego guy from Duke Nukem, and shooting was a bit more like Quake. So this was the last boss, Unicorn. So why the scenery is all red, why it's suddenly Mexican and chili stuff? So Because it's unicorn. It's a big giant corn, and I couldn't think, we couldn't really think of a better way. Also, I like Mexican food, so why not? Some people actually love the third scenario the most, and some people thought it's racist. I guess because of this, of this tomato man, and maybe this. So he has a little carrot belt around his, and some weird beard. So yeah, on the right, there's this stand on GDC, and yeah, I even took one of my terrible selfies there to prove that I was there. I think I shouldn't turn this into how I went to the GDC. It was definitely fun, worth it. I like used every bit of the event. I gained lots of contacts and learned a lot of stuff about game industry and how to not make games. So last part. Finally, I negotiated a fixed release date, 19th of July. Added Steam achievements, leaderboards, and cloud saves. That was one of the reasons why I wanted to create a game in the first place. I finally wanted to create some stupid achievements, and the Gory Tale had 28 of them, and they were like really stupid. Like one of the achievements was follow the map, or shoot cannon through donuts hole, or something like that. Beta testing, balancing and polishing, adding last sound effects, like 3 days prior to game release, I guess we added some last sound effects to Chili, for example. I wasn't the one doing the sounds, but still it was funny. And finally, voice lines. We had a Canadian voice actor doing voices for me. So, and this was the moment, publish the game. I mean, it's not really that you publish it and go live and everybody sees it. It's still the date there, but I still had to push the button, where in the game it says, do not press the red button. And yeah, it's the ending of the game. So last part, it was a bit of mixed feelings. Watching Unity performance reports, it was really frustrating because I used out CPP and I had lots of Steam SDK errors. Watching, which I fixed later on, and some of weird scripting order errors that I fixed also later. I watched analytics and Steam numbers. Yes, finally I can do that. I'm a real game developer now. I mean, Steam developer. First 2 weeks were like of my life. They were like pretty rapid bug fixing. Then what I did, I separated release candidates in development beta branches. And what happened, when I fixed bugs, I push them to release candidates, and then when I had a release candidate, we would test it on Steam and then switch it to production if all is right. But if we had something that was crashing the game, something like whatever, it just breaks something and doesn't feel good for the user, like it's game-changing bug. We had the cut fixes that were pushed straight to the production. Yeah, this didn't really cause any problems. I think once it did. I made a hot fix that broke the game completely. So I, oh, damn, and I pushed it again, and fine. So yeah, that was the last part of the development phase. It was something like this. And it was the most intense one, I guess. And we were two guys supporting the game at all times. Mostly it was me, but I had the other guy who could help me with, managing community or fixing some bug while I fixed the other and something like that. So this is a list of all the participants in Gorytale. The first is me. I am project manager, developer, and everything else. But basically, something needs to be done. It sometimes happened that I did some modeling or made sound effects or added sound effects, gameplay. Everything mostly was done by me, if possible. I mean, if there was nobody at the time doing that. Then there was Sergen Altundas, who also was a backup developer, but he was really busy, and he was there and not there, but he really helped me during the last 4 months or last 5 months of the development. Ģirts Ķesteris, he created the scenario 2 and 3 and the characters from scenario 2. So basically, modeling. Sergen, he was a glue. He did both. He did Unity effects and models, 3D stuff, textures. Basically, something I needed, he did it. Then was Rudolf Balzer, who created Environment Scenario 1. And I didn't add, but he also created Arena 2. But that doesn't make that much of sense, maybe. But basically, mostly it's scenario one. But he defined how game looks like. He was a really important guy for Gorytale. So how the game looks like and how the world looks like is sort of his work. Then we had an Estonian guy, Markus Limet. I'm not sure how to pronounce his surname. He did characters for scenario 1 and 2, half of the scenario for 2. So he was the guy who made how the characters look like. I mean, the first 3 ones. And he really likes anime, so that's one of the reasons why those characters look like anime. And again, those are 3D people. Jirs Linkums, that was the fish guy, the Zeus. So he did sound effects and marketing initially. And finally, Tom Samson, who helped me during the last stages to create scenarios. 3 characters like Chili, Tomato, Samu, and I guess the cheese man whose real name is Diario. Something like that. So, but one of the best things about the game is, it's the main theme of the game. The original idea was that there was this guy, Silver Contos, I guess, maybe somebody, so back at Ludum Dare 41, I asked, we can't find a decent, stupid main menus like music. Can you help us out? And he sent me YouTube link to Happy Party Animals, hardcore Happy Party Animals. And oh yeah, that fits totally. So, and then, that was pretty nice. But I had one of my Lithuanian friends, I would say, Viktoras Grečko. He made a new version out of pretty close, not really that close, but basically he used that sound, that original, like that soundtrack as a reference and created a new one. Basically, I didn't have like any royalty issues anymore. So, and then in the game, when you are killing everything else, like all the music except the main thing is done by Eugene Golovkin. He's also Lithuanian from both upper ones. I mean, they're both from Klaipeda. He did an awesome job. He created metal music, and for example, And one instance, what I loved about him, I asked him, we have this morning mood where you appear in heaven, going to the saint, some heaven dude. somebody said that he's St. Peter's. No, he's heaven dude. So you're going there, and there's this morning mood music, and of course I couldn't add it to the final version because it's copyrighted. The execution was copyrighted. I can't remember the name exactly, but basically he created Peer Gynt Morning Wood full composition just for me. I said, oh, I just need 30 seconds, and it was 4.5 minutes, and done pretty nicely. And then we had a Canadian voice actor, Isaac Wells, who did voice acting for us. So it wasn't Isaac.
Isaac.
Sorry. Yeah. So. He did the voice acting for us, for the main character and for the god, Kevin guy, I would say. So it was pretty fun. He did all the Duke Nukem style voices. And maybe the most important part is launch and performance, how the game performed at the market. Expectations were like, oh yeah, we have this, yeah, sure. And reality was something like that, so. Actually, this is our unofficial logo now. So, gameplay. This was one of the things that worried me. We had 1.5 hours of gameplay. And when we published the game, we had a speedrun. It was finished in 16 minutes and 38 seconds. But I was like, oh, somebody actually, there's speedrun entry. Oh, nice. And yeah, I would play the game, and it took me about 30 minutes per each scenario. So 1.5 hours, not much. We'll be fine. We have another mode, arena mode, where you have leaderboards to increase game longevity. And then I looked at the Steam leaderboard records yesterday, and there was 86 entries, 41 entries for the second arena, for the third one, 25. And it proved that arena mode wasn't played that often. People were playing the story, not the arena mode. So meaning, if I would make the story over again, I would start it not so slow, but a bit more epic. Basically, when you start the game, you get the game like in your face. Just you go there and kill those things. It's like some sort of dream and whatever. And then you go to this gates person, heaven dude, and then continue. But our social stuff. So Twitter. It was the most active our most active social platform where we did something. But it's mostly other game developers, right? So there's some people, some gamers there and looking, but not that much. It's like, it's more like I would, most of the people I would reach out were other game developers and were, oh yeah, I like this direction, oh yeah. I could validate how some game mechanics were popular, but I was really biased by whether real users would like that much. So.
Thank you for leaving.
Yeah, Aita?
Yeah.
So, Facebook, page and groups. Basically, I created a page, why not? It was the initial homepage, sort of, and groups just basically post that, oh yeah, we're gonna finish the game, launch it the 19th of July. Reddit, it got some traction, but I didn't know how to really control the force of Reddit. In image Gore, I am Gore, I don't know how to pronounce it. It was a big surprise. One post got 60,000 views. Like, seriously, I was confused. I wasn't aware that this thing was good for game marketing. So one of my colleagues actually showed me how it works, and give power, and people actually read stuff there. It's just I was more about this. Oh, I have this one screenshot, and it will explain everything. Maybe some text. It was like that in Twitter, in Reddit, but in IamGore, it worked differently. People actually read what you write, and they prefer some story, some small stories. Discord and Discord are a little public channel. So how it turned out? So what I written down hastily, what I can remember from social stuff. Facebook page ads did not convert very well to wishlist. It was a waste of money, I would say. Or I did it completely wrong. I tested several ways. I could get some likes for Facebook page from Eastern Europe. Really good, but they weren't converted to wishlists. Best time to post is around 19th till 7 o'clock till 10 o'clock, like every day. This is the moment where Europeans are still up and Americans have morning. So that's why post your social stuff at that time on Twitter or Facebook and that stuff. I don't know, just works. Use 3 to 4 hashtags, no more, because if you do more of them, some social platforms tend to ignore you then, if you have like 1,000 hashtags, because I have this game, Trump, Latvia, Riga, NATO, and some other hashtags just randomly I added there, and just people are like, what is this shit? What? But one more thing that's pretty important, use stuff like screenshot that Saturdays and Marketing Mondays, like those events, to add something there. And people, it's pretty popular. GIFs are underrated. It was underrated for me at first. It was working really well. And Imgore, I don't know how to pronounce it again. It was a big surprise. Surprise. Try it sometime to, for example, try to validate your game idea there to see whether there's traction from your little post to understand whether you want to proceed with the game idea at all. That's how one of my colleagues works with this social site. But one thing, do not directly reference your product in those social sites and Reddit, because people, oh, this is marketing, FU. So they think, oh yeah, this is a pretty cool game. Can I get a link to Steam page? Oh yeah, sure, here you go. But only when they ask. So basically, if you would, oh yeah, this is our blah 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 blah, this is so awesome, and here's Steam page, people would probably look like it's a marketing material, whatever. It's just, it works just like that. So having a landing page is super important. And what I did, there's this Xola thing. I tried to use it for, I had a landing page. Why? They had new options for influencer campaigns, basically getting some YouTube streamers and Mixer and Twitch streamers directly to your homepage, and try just ask for access to your game, and you just allow them, and they just get the influencer stuff. And advertorial campaigns, jeez, I can't pronounce it. So was it worth it? No. because of bureaucracy, and it was a pretty late game when I added a new landing page for Xola. It didn't work out that well, so it was just too late. But one of the most important things where if you want to launch your game, you need to have a press kit. So basically, we had a press subdomain for Gorytale.com that led to press kit. Basically, what's a press kit? It basically contains information and assets for the press. I mean, they can find everything there. They have GIFs there, they have images there, they have information to about the game, when it's gonna be out, a link to Steam, for example, because press people, journalists are pretty lazy people. Actually, they aren't that lazy. I mean, they have lots of stuff going on, so they want to do something as soon as possible. And one of the reasons is just you have all the information. Send this one link, and they might take something out of it, or they just gonna ask for a press release. Please send me your press release, and we're gonna post it. So game media, what happened with the Gory Tale release? So I gather press information and contacts. It took some while, but I have a big spreadsheet now. Cool. I sent game keys to 75 game media entities. 2 weeks before release, 3 days before release, and at the day of release, I sent to the most important ones. I thought who were the most important ones on the release, but 2 weeks and 3 days before, it was 75 media entities. Basically, emails fill their forms in their social sites. So what happened? 12 keys. I mean, 75. Sent 75 keys, and 12 keys were redeemed. So meaning that maybe about 20 actually read my email. Maybe 12 tried to open redeem the key in Steam. But it resulted in 6 media coverage cases. So the coverage percentage is pretty low for game media. Was it worth it? Yes, I got TechRaptor media coverage. It was pretty big. But important, what was important here? Have a spreadsheet and have all your stuff there. Who have you contacted? When? What's the key? So have like an internal database of what key has been sent to what, and then from that you can understand whether they have actually checked it or not. So, and here again, important was press kit, this thing. And even then, if I had the press kit, some of them asked me for press release, basically, where I have made an article for media, and they would just copy paste and post it. So, but the most important thing for us was influencer streams, because our game was silly, stupid, little, fast-paced game that were supposed to attract streamers. So we didn't have a streaming embargo prior to release, meaning that if somebody get the key and had access to early version of the Gory Tale, they could stream immediately. Sometimes people ask for streaming embargo, they can just post their streams after release or 3 days before or something like that. We didn't have that. Why? I didn't think about it. But one thing I learned is that I wasn't that aware of that. So streamers are interested in accessing a new title before it's public. So it's the moment where it's there and it's not yet available to the public. It's the most valuable thing for the streamers, and use it wisely. Use, because if you're not using this value for the streamers, it basically you just killed your game for streamers. Later on, there some of them will be, play the game, but the biggest interest is before the release, the week before the release. So give them access to your game then, or not after it's released. And the game was created on promise that it will be interesting to streamers. That's one of the reasons why we wanted to finish the game in the first place. So, some statistics. Influencers and streams for Gory Tale. Total YouTube, there was were about 70 cases of streams. I was expecting less, actually. But we had 70 streams, yay. Actually, it's not that much, but I was expecting maybe 40, maybe. So, the biggest streamer was Throneful. He had 1.23 million followers, but it didn't convert convert that much. There weren't many viewers for the stream. There were like maybe 1,000 views total for the stream, for this biggest streamer. But the biggest stream with the most viewers, it was 8.1k views, quite recently actually. On Twitch we had 6 videos. I didn't count live streams because I don't have the information about that. So, but here I used a thing called Keymailer. I got 33 YouTube. Basically I got 33 YouTube coverages from Keymailer. It's almost half from 70. That's much, right? Twitch too, it's 1/3 maybe, I would say. And how much I got from the Ixola, the thing, what was the reason why I wanted them in the first place? 8. I was just too late with the stuff. So Keymailer worked the best for us. And I think it will, if I would do that again, I would just go full Keymailer and as soon as possible. So, and there's this thing called Steam Curators. So it's good for game quality validation for a coming user. I'm checking for this small game. It costs, I know, 10 euros. And I'm checking, oh, there's this Steam Curator thing. It's recommended by 5 Steam Curators. I think I might buy it. Because one of the things is, if there are small company games who don't have like much marketing, they tend to have little reviews, and therefore their positive or very positive or mostly positive is not that optimal, I would say. So I would check Steam Curator what they have said about the game. So, and what they do, they give either recommended or not recommended. So, but basically what are Steam Curators? It's basically mixed folk of game developers, game journalists, gamers and streamers. Journalists. So offered keys 86 and 14 were reviewed, and all recommended our game. Some of them were, oh yeah, we're gonna recommend your game, just send you your key. Okay, fine. So, and it's pretty important that you have, I see that they gathered the information from our press kit. What's our email? Or from Steam. So, committee management. We had that, yes, sort of. So, we have a Discord server with a public channel. I didn't pay enough time and energy for this. And that was one of the biggest mistakes of the whole project. It's one of the most important factors whether the title survives after its release or not. The game is released. Is there some community supporting it? Will it continue living on? Yeah, it's released, and that, for example, will there be Gory Tale 2, the return of whatever? It's one of the reasons why games stick is community. And one of the things is that I understood that indie developers tend to spend about 30% of their time. I mean, if there's a solo developer that's creating his game, he's spending about 35% of their time managing their communities. I mean that's hell of a lot of time. Like, where's the rest of your time? I mean, 30% for the marketing and the rest for the game development. It will take years to finish your game, but it's how it works. And what's the percentage I invested? 5 to 10%, maybe. I would say 5-7. I don't know. Depends. So, perfect performance on Steam. So, prior to release, it was 476 wishlists. I was looking at that number and I was, geez, this is bad. It's not gonna perform well. But, okay, then. So, it was an omen. Decently successful games need to have about 3K or 10,000 wish lists somewhere in between to perform well, but some had said that it's 30,000. So, and mine, 476, it's nothing. One.
Somebody knocked?
Huh?
Somebody knocked?
No, I don't think. So, one thing that I did foolishly, I gave some keys away to friends for free. Don't do that. Why? Ask them to buy it or buy the game for them and ask in return for them to review your game. Because which reviews count in Steam? Those who bought the game. So I had friends who got the key and accessed the game. It was basically, they received the game for free, they added review, it didn't really matter. It showed there, but it didn't count in statistics. So this was the biggest mistake that I did when publishing my game. So, what happened? In first 3 days we got about 150 purchases. I was like, oh no shit. I mean, it was, in the second day it was already 100. I was like, oh yeah, we are one of the most successful Latvian Steam games ever, which isn't saying much. Well, there are way more successful games, of course. And I wouldn't say our game performed well. Wishlist count increased about to 750. Oh, I was like confused because I was waiting that wishlists would decrease. It didn't happen. It didn't decrease. In the first 3 days, about 80 people were at the Steam page at all times. About it lasted for 3 days. First 3 days, Steam is basically just directing traffic to the new release title. Third to the seventh day, we had a traffic daily, like at all times, about 20, 25-ish, 30. And after 1 week, I didn't add like 1 week, they pulled the plug. Basically, what happened, organic searches went there. So they didn't drive any traffic. Why? It needed 3K purchases for further Steam traffic boost, and we didn't have that. And also, we had about 150, and I can't remember the how many reviews they needed that there to do that. So yeah, you need to plan for this when you release your game, or publisher can do that. So, but today, how it performs today? 390 purchases, yay! Wishlists, it has increased till 1,583. I am confused. I'm not really confused. I'm happy that I have more wishlists than prior to release. It was 476. Nice. 41 were returned or chargeback. I mean, chargeback or return, they basically ask for a refund, or bank issues with cards. You know, what's a chargeback, right? So basically meaning that Steam has information that they got their money, but later on they got the information, oh, we actually didn't. So it's a chargeback. That's one of the reasons, that one of the things how at some pages people get keys with chargeback. I mean, how they get keys and then resell them later, because you still have the key. And but the best thing about the game, it actually paid back my financial investments. Yay. But not the time I wasted them there. It's time is all. If I would say time is money, I would count my time there. No, it didn't pay back, but it was totally worth it. Oh yeah, you could see that maybe on the release date was July 19th, and on July 20th, because you know the Americas and Europe stuff, we had about almost 8,000 viewers at one date, and we totally have 65,000 viewers. What happened is, you see that there's a steady decline over first week, then it's something is going on, and then in August and September, I made some patches, there were bigger activities, and then in September I did additional patch and again some activity. So if you create a patch, there's some activity happening, but I haven't yet checked how it performed that well. So yeah, we had a good one, and I'm talking for a while, we're getting to the end. Takeaways, you can form your own takeaways. For example, one of the things, Ģirts, you're a moron, you should have found a publisher, or you shouldn't have created the game in the first place, something like that. But yeah, sure. These are my takeaways. So manage game communities to sustain game longevity. Yeah, don't be a control freak like I happened to be in the first part of the project, and then slowly I went to YOLO. Just if you want to do something, do something. So find the middle balance. At the end I did find it. Don't be a full control freak while ensure that things are done consistently, because in the moment when they weren't, later on I had to redo them and fix some of the issues. Some of them weren't, some of them were. So find the balance of being, if you're a project manager, find the balance of being, not being a control freak, and ensure that things are done consistently. Maybe the most important one, and people were telling me this when I was developing the game and prior to it. If you don't have a marketing, if you don't have marketing people who know what they're doing, I mean, I'm talking about game. I'm not talking about the general marketing whatsoever. I'm talking about game industry marketing. If you don't have that, get a publisher. Basically, then you will learn how it works. Like I did it in the not in a good manner. Imgur proved to be a really good tool for getting some traction. I was surprised. So Kimmeler got the most streamers to play the game. Steam reviews are important. Go and so meaning that don't give friends free keys without giving a thought and talking to them. The question: do you want to write a review? Fuck no. Then then you have can have your free key, or you want to support me and buy it. Okay, fine. But if they are ready to write a review, you can buy it for them, and they can write the review. Or if they want to buy it, let them buy it. So Steam reviews are important. Don't, copy paste. One thing, list game on Steam as soon as possible to slowly get wish lists. We did it halfway through development, and we could have done that 4 months earlier. We already had the visuals and the attraction factors to the game. If you have them, it's just put it there and people will react somehow. So you will get some wish lists. Better 100 than nothing. So polishing takes a lot of time, and finishing a game needs some serious dedication. I mean, that happened to me. So the most time I spent on the game, it was polishing it. And finishing a game required a hell of a lot of dedication to it. Like it wasn't healthy anymore, I would say. Oh yeah. So this was pretty much my my presentation, like this wall of text. And I think a lot of information. Maybe some of that was important, some of that wasn't. Each will take away what they want from it. The future, I had to include, Back to the Future. So, I'm gonna test how we're gonna have our first sale on Gory Tale. We released it on 19th of July this year, and it will be autumn sale next week. I'm not sure whether I should tell, because Steam is pretty secretive about this thing. So but it's gonna be in at the end of October, and it's gonna be available if you want to buy the game, buy it. So after then, we wanted to have like Gory Tale scenario 4. This is the heaven dude and badly shaved hand at this scene. So we will have scenario 4, and it has something to do with this heaven dude. We wanted to have this scenario for this autumn sale, but we'll probably have it before either Doom Eternal, like week before Doom Eternal. Why not? Because Doom Eternal sale, or before Christmas, because of the theme. Maybe we haven't figured it out yet. So, but the thing that I'm currently working on is Gory Tale VR. So Yeah. And it's really terrible. Look at his face. I mean, he has his goggles on, and he can't stand it. So I think it was way funnier for me than everyone else, but it's still something. So it will basically work on Quest, Oculus Quest. Basically, it's a standalone VR device without any stuff. Without any wires and wire an Oculus Rift. But for me to do so, I have to create my own interaction system. So yeah, and I have that already. So and why it will be a separate title from Gory Tale, because it will have different mechanics, because in the VR I'll have to recreate like from scratch different shooting mechanics and how AI works and that kind of stuff. And also, I just said it's a different title. And also, yeah, some marketing people suggested me to do that. Also, it's my master's thesis. Aite? Again, my name is Ģirts Ķesteris, so yeah, I'm trying to speak the only thing I know in Estonian, so thank you. Yes, it was almost an hour. It was 84 slides. So, questions, are there any questions?
Have you also used, or is there any, do you have any obstacles at the Unity? Where I want to go is that the Unity and Unreal, you are more like a Unity guy, at least some situations where you think that, okay, here maybe the Unreal is better.
So, I'm not really an Unreal guy. I haven't played with Unreal that much, so. But I can say sometimes I get frustrated with how Unity handles things, especially if you're talking about performance. I mean, if you want for something to perform on Unity, you need to. Especially if it's something massive, I mean, like you have massive amounts of entities like in AIs and that kind of stuff, you basically have to avoid, for example, model behaviors, you have to avoid the default way how Unity works. You have to create your own engine within an engine, so to fix that problem. And that's not just for performance or just, it's like a typical problem for Unity. You have to create an engine to fix Unity's problems that they have created from that Unity works like that from the beginning. I mean, it's Unity is still the one engine that I am proficient at, and the rest of them are like, oh yeah, I am Godot developer wannabe, and I have opened Unreal and tried to create something about 15 times, but I wouldn't say that I have Unreal experience, so I don't have anything to compare it to. Yeah, did I answer your question?
Yes.
But basically, Unity typically has issues that you need to create for some small issue. You need to fix some small issue. You need to create your own engine within an engine, and maybe if you're using some engine within Unity, some custom engine, basically that's an engine under engine, but you're creating another engine under that engine, so you have engine, like typical problem for Unity. But it's not just for Unity, so yeah, also for web projects or something like that, so but yeah.
So nothing is impossible, you just have to use some backdoors to get in.
I would say if you're aiming for AAA quality, or I might rethink of using Unity. I mean, if it's super realistic, Unity for some it's not there yet. It's trying to be AAA title, but you can't. You have to sacrifice a bunch of stuff to look for something to look right. While in the Unreal, it's pretty simple to do something like that. So, but I'm not really an expert into AAA title stuff. So I'm more like indie stuff, basically creating something small and performant and small tier devices. Then like, I want to work on AAA title. I don't know. So first, I can say that the HD render pipeline is fine, but it could be better. But it's mostly for cinematics and that kind of stuff, not for AAA titles. That's my opinion. Yeah. I can. So there are some questions in stream, right?
Actually, not anymore. Just the one.
So the most challenging feature in the game. Oh. So the game, one of the things about this game, it was pretty simple. I mean, it wasn't like a big super tech achievement for me. I have done a bunch of stuff like that previously. It was all about, getting out there in Steam and polishing stuff and that kind of stuff. But I would say one of the most challenging things I had was, I mean, most complex, it was, I wouldn't say it was complex, I would say the most challenging thing was Steam leaderboards. Why? Because there was this issue with Unity, by default uses Mono as their scripting backend when you build stuff. But I used, for performance reasons, and I wanted to switch to AutoCPP, so it's harder for you to decompile my game. Where basically AutoCPP compiles to C++ code and then to bytecode. And what was the problem with Steamworks SDK leaderboards? There was an issue. They weren't working without the CPP, and I didn't see that until the game. When I started testing release candidates, I mean, it had some weird issues. I mean, at this address, something is not working. There's something missing, but I don't really know what's missing. So there was this ops, like this small message, what didn't say much about what was the issue there. So after some days of digging, it led me to something similar, but by C# community, and then back to the, I found some keywords, then it led back me to Steamworks Unity SDK with one issue where it, we have this issue with information, we have this issue, it doesn't work on AutoCPP, and I was too stubborn to use Mono. I wanted to use AutoCPP because, yes, I want to do that. I'm a stubborn donkey again. And I found a way after additional days of forum searching, I found a way how to specify which assembly to use for one certain method that was the problem all along. And it worked. So now currently I have a custom Steamworks SDK version for my Gory Tale. The leaderworks part. So that was the most complex thing I think I did. But gameplay wise, I would say the most thing the most complex thing, but I liked it. Getting everything balanced and everything to tell a story. I mean, that it's not just you can drop one model. It looks like something that people would ultimately understand what it is, or you need to somehow introduce something for people or explain it via story. And I didn't want to use cutscenes and use as little UI as possible. I need to make it people understand what the hell is that in action. So that was one of the hardest things to do. And yeah, that's one of the things that made it took a hell of a lot of time to do that. And yeah, that's one of the reasons why technically I could create one this small arena fast, but I needed to work it a bit better work on UX. So yeah.
The key mailer thing.
Yep.
How does that work?
So key mailer is basically you basically ask Steam for keys. They send you a batch of keys, and one of the things about the keys, I'm gonna bit move off the topic first. If you get keys from Steam, save them somewhere on the spreadsheet, so you don't lose them, because you're not going to get them again. They're going to be in the email, maybe. Yes, they send you via email, so it's still in the email, but you don't really have a real reference to which and why did you order these keys if you have several batches. So you basically, I would suggest you basically create a spreadsheet and for what reason each key is. So, but how it works, you import, for example, 100 or 200, 300 keys in your Gmail account. So, and then you have information about your game, leading, for example, you had press kit there, leading to your press kit. And influencers are going daily, just they're searching for content for their streaming. Basically, they have channels there. They want to stream something, right? But they have to find what to stream, what is some new silly game or something like that. So basically they're going through a list of games, and one of your title might happen to be there. So they're asking for access for a game. So you either accept or decline or ignore. So if you accept, they're gonna send a Steam key to the user, and they're gonna redeem it on Steam. Sometimes they don't redeem them, sometimes they ignore. Also, you can just have like a key mailer widget somewhere on your site. They can press and get access to your game, something like that. So it's all about, basically it's a platform where you basically give access to your keys. But one of the problems about Keymailer, but it's not just about Keymailer, I mean, there are many phony streamers, meaning that, I'm gonna give some attention, I mean, exposure to your game, give me a key. And all I see that, for example, they have this accredited users and everybody else. I was ignoring mostly all unaccredited, and I was checking accredited each of the streamer who asked me. I tested who he was, and then I sent the key. It wasn't just apply for everything. So what I did, if a person had more than 1K streamers. Then 1K streamer, for example, 10,000 till 500,000 are considered mid-tier streamers, and those are the best for your title if they're streaming stuff. don't aim for the big ones. If some of the big ones get try you, it's awesome, but there, if you're gonna try to bombard them with emails, they're not gonna respond. So try 10,000 till 500,000. They're the streamers for new titles. They're pretty good. Yeah, and they're pretty interested in having your game and test it out and either shit on the game or, oh yeah, this is so funny and terrible. And so yeah, they want this attention. So basically, yeah, content for them, exposure for you. Cool. Also, some people tend to send emails and ask for access, but I need some research to do, additional research to understand who the hell are they, and should I send a key to them or not. So yeah, did I answer your question?
Yeah.
It was a bit long, but
I tried to
add some things I learned during the whole development process that I didn't tell into the presentation. See, if I would, I could have like 5 presentations like this about this project, so, oh jeez.
Follow-up question, do you know how many, I don't know, months of work did you put into it, and would you do it again?
So, how many months I added there? I don't know. Straight. So one of the thing I was working and developing this game, and then I started my master's, and it went to hell pretty quickly. I mean, so I wasn't sleeping that much. I was by the computer developing the game like all the time. And then for some months I just went into development cave. Nobody would see me again from there. I was there in the room, sort of. I was there, but not really present. So it was for me that for some months. I mean, she's the one who will know that. So
1.5 years.
1.5 years. Technically, it was the development, but there were some months where I didn't do anything for the game because I was like overburned. And then I got back, and I went to the development cave, then I got burned. But how many months straight, I don't know.
And if you include the whole team, like whole work that went into this?
So, geez. My months, I would say it was 2-3 months of pure development. Whole team, maybe additional month. Month and a half, maybe. I don't know, because the term indie developer doesn't mean that you just program. You also create stuff. You balance it. In my case, later I did marketing, whole game journal stuff, the publishing part. There was, for example, 1 week where I didn't write a line of code whatsoever. All I did was marketing and how to release and that kind of stuff. And yeah, it would be better if I had a marketing person, but I was too stubborn because it's too late. It's already been published and there's no use currently to have a new and introduce a member to the team and introduce to the project, because it takes a hell of a lot of time to do that and for them to adapt. About what it was, it worth it?
Did you do it again?
Was it worth it? Yes. Would I do it again? Not like this. I would do some things quite differently. One of the things I wouldn't do, I wouldn't be that much of control freak. Then I would have more people working on my game, I guess. At the mid and late part of the project, so that's one of the things I learned big time. Let's see what future holds. Yeah, I'm not a control freak anymore. I'm developing my VR title currently alone. But it's mostly because it's my master's thesis, so. Yeah, more questions? Happy to answer?
Not from this stream, if you have.
Yeah. Ah, yeah, also I have a terrible email now. Arnold@nyard.com. Yeah, sure. So at first we had some info at nyarn.com, but it was too boring. And then people started just when they were asked, you know, hi, whatever, they would start with, hi Arnold. It's like, so yeah. Well, it definitely was fun. The project sort of started here and I published it. It's a success, all right, and those who, and now I have a completely different look on the people who actually try to publish it something and actually try to market them and get some purchases and understand how the whole process work. Because prior to it I was just working on tech stuff, did some mobile publishing, but not indie stuff. I mean, not PC indie stuff. It's a different beast. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. So ending stream, right? Oh God, leaderboard. Imgur is imager. Oh, thanks.